We're doing a couple things right now, which is why we look the way we look. Like we're really tired or something.
We are tired. Through every night.
We're working on an album here in Elgin. There's a really great studio called Roswell Leagues. It's for what you pay, it's an unbelievable studio. It's pretty good. And I don't know if y'all are familiar with the band called This Train or not, but they're from here in Elgin. We just got done with maybe the second or third tour that we've done with them. They're very popular nationally, but a lot of times people from their hometown they have a studio here. We're working on that, but we're also working on the concert that we're doing this fall. So we wanted to try some of those songs out on you. We're going to be getting ready. I hope you don't mind. And it feels very. I have to say that it's. Quite moving to be here. And to hear y'all sing, and you sing so badly. And after spending years and years doing studio work where everyone is so uptight about everything, it's just, I grew up in the church in Indiana. I grew up, I had Christian parents, and they never made us go to church because I always loved to go to church because growing up, that was about the only place in Indiana where men actually sing. And when I grew up on a farm and I heard men cuss a lot and I heard men fight and I heard all that kind of thing, but church was a place where men sang and they sang badly, and that was another thing that I loved about it was that they weren't ashamed of how bad they were, and I've always felt like church is the one place in the world where you should be able to go and not be ashamed. Because if the other people had it together, they wouldn't need to be there either. We're all kind of here because we need each other. And that you would allow us to be a part of this really wonderful gathering is quite an honor for us. And we deeply appreciate y'all's hospitality and this whole thing. I'm going to do a song now that kind of changed the course of my life. A lot of people ask me how I got into Christian music. And my standard answer is that in a former life, I must have beat up a lot of musicians, and I'm being punished now. Because I never intended to be a Christian musician. I'm a reluctant musician. I wanted to be a jock, but I don't have any athletic skill at all. And I never really meant to be a Christian. I've just always been very unsuccessful at sinning. It's never worked out for me like it works out for people in movies and stuff. So I decided at some point you just give in. You get tired of fighting with God, and from the outside you decide to give in and fight with Him from the inside. And that's kind of how I was converted. And but this song, for years I worked in a retreat ministry called Zion Ministries. And we were just struggling along. And I lived in the third floor of a house in Cincinnati because there was about 10 guys that lived in this house. And depending on how much money you had to pay for rent, you got the lower floors because they were heated better. And I had so little money, I was in the attic with one other guy. And we had to sleep together for the 2 years that I lived there because he had an electric blanket. And I woke him up one night, my teeth were chattering so loud. And he said, why don't you just sleep with me? That way it'll be, I can get some sleep and you can't sleep. And for years, I think it was really tough for my parents because they thought that I was going to, they didn't think that I was making the smartest choice in the world by doing what I was doing, but I really believed in it. And so my uncle finally loaned me $1,000 to make a demo with. And we recorded this song on that demo, and a copy of it got in the hands of Amy Grant, and she decided to record it. And when she recorded it, it made so much money that it just changed everything. I'm still kind of recuperating. She she did do it wrong, There's this long middle section that I really liked because it was all taken out of the scriptures. And so as a sort of an attempt to redeem myself, I decided to re-record it and do it the way that I had originally written it, because in the Christian music industry, you just make so many compromises that over the course of the years, you realize that you've not only compromised on your artistic integrity, but in many ways you compromise your own faith. And at the end of it all, you only have 30 silver pieces to show for what you've done. So we're as corrupt as Judas and not nearly as economically minded as he is. So this is that song that probably is the reason that you all are here today.
Yeah. But actually, one problem that I have as a writer is just that there's so much great music out there already, it hardly seems necessary to write anymore. This is a mandolin. And we're going to, this will be the first time we've played this in front of people, so I'm a little nervous. But this is a piece that was written by Johann Sebastian Bach, who was I think a lot of Christians have this inferiority complex where they think that we only imitate what the world has. And the reality of the thing is, when you go back, anyone who studies the history of European music knows that all the great music from possibly about the 3rd century until about the 16th century all came out of the church. And probably because the church had money and nobody else did. But the church has always been way ahead, and even rock and roll is the gift of the church to the world. And I think the world has handled it badly, but it's still our invention, and we should be proud of it. Amen. So we're going to attempt to play a Bach double violin concerto, but it was written for violins, and we're going to try to do it on mandolin. Okay, so you ready?
Yeah.
It's right.
anybody have a capo?
Yeah. Capo. Put on your guitar.
Sorry. See what I mean? No athletic ability. I don't know if I've introduced you to Eric yet, but Eric is a guy, Mitch and I moved out to the Navajo Reservation about 2.5 years ago, and we've been living there ever since, as much as we live anywhere, when we're not living here at the cruises. And so one morning we went over to the gas station and I saw Eric and a friend of his, and I went, oh man, those guys are having a blast, because they're a couple young guys who are too stupid to dress nice. They just looked like they were young and didn't know where they were going, and that was exactly the case. And so we met them and found out that Eric is a cellist. And not only is he a cellist, but he's a very good cellist. And so now we travel together, and he's got me to where I don't look like I know where I'm going or what I'm doing, and I don't. So we get along very well. Mitch, I met when I was in college at Friends University, and I first got to know him in a class that we were taking on. What was that class? Some religion class. And the professor put he and I in a small group together because I talk a lot, and Mitch has a reputation for being somewhat quiet. And he thought maybe Mitch could help me to not talk so much, and I could help Mitch to talk more. And I got to know him, and I was going, man, what a great guy. I really liked him. We kind of started hanging out. And then one day I was visiting another friend of ours in the dorm room, and Mitch came in, and the guy gave me a guitar and said, hey, play this. And I was going, oh, this will be awful, because I really like Mitch, and I really don't want to have to go, wow, that's a nice-looking guitar you got. So he played this song, and I was blown away, because I had no idea that he was such a good player or such a good writer. And we've been working together ever since. And this is, it's his album that we're working on here, and so I'm going to let it, I'm going to have him do a couple songs.
Well, did it work? Do you talk more now and he talk less?
No.
You didn't know what to say.
Showers us with light. This is only, yeah. The sun is Thank you. Work left to do, but so much it all
already done. Oh God, you are my God, and I will ever praise you. Oh God, you are my God, and I will ever praise you. And I will seek you in the morning, and I will learn to walk in your way.
Sitting up in heaven on an easy chair, sipping lemonade, but lives there.
keys on, keeping it on. Now he ain't quite washed, you won't find him on the corner praying. He just knows his love and knows his song, and he sings, I've got all I want. Cause I've got my love, and one day I'll be sitting up in heaven on an easy chair, sipping lemonade, love lives there. One day I'll be sitting up in heaven on an easy chair, sipping lemonade, love lives there. Yeah, one day I'll be sitting up in heaven on an easy chair, sipping lemonade, love lives there.
You forget about us, after you have flown away. Well, I've memorized every word you said. Till I'm so scared I'm holding my breath. While you're up there just playing hard to get. You live in radiance, hear the prayers of those of us who live in skin. We have this love that's not as patient as yours, but still we do love now and then. But did you ever know loneliness? Did you ever feel the need? Do you remember just how long nights you get? But you're just barely holding on, and your friends all fall asleep. You don't see the blood that's running in your sweat. But those who mourn be left uncomfortable. While you're up there just playing hard to get. I know you bore our sorrow. And I know that it would not hurt any less, even if it could be explained. And I know that I'm only lashing out at the one who loves me most. When I've gone, I've figured this all out. I know the only thing I really need is if you who live in eternity hear the prayers of those of us who live in time. We can't see what's ahead, and we cannot get free from what we've left behind. And I'm reeling from these voices that keep screaming in my ears. All these words of shame and doubt, blame and regret. Can't see how you're leading me unless you led me here to where I'm lost enough to let myself be there. So you've been here all along, your ways, and you are just plain hard to get. God to inspire confidence. And what God wants to inspire is fear. We want God to give us all kinds of assurances. And what God wants to give us is faith. And we want to become healthy and prosperous and unaffected by the world. And He wants us to encounter the world in such a way as He did, which is the way that will eventually kill us. So we ask for all the wrong things, and we get all the wrong things. That's why I think it's hard for a rich person to get into heaven, because they've been going the wrong direction so long, it's hard to turn around. You get awfully big, and you have all that assurance and all that confidence and all that jazz. It's just hard to give it up to get anywhere you really want to go. So, if you're a very brave person, I highly recommend a serious reading of the scriptures. And instead of always trying to understand it so that it fits your theology, I just really like to challenge you to read it and say that's what it says. And of course it doesn't make sense, it's true. The truth very seldom makes sense. Okay, so did you ask for... Oh.
Oh, okay. Is that an album
now? Yeah. Oh, it is. Okay,
well, they're getting their instruments out.
Well, they're getting their instruments out. A lot of people ask me why I don't write love songs. And I've written several. It's just, I don't have a lot of inspiration. I haven't even had a date in a decade, so. But I did have a date with this girl in Ireland. And, In fact, we dated for about 3 weeks in Ireland. And, like, at the end, you know, you can see, well, this really isn't going to go anywhere, so I was kind of embarrassed. So, I wrote her this song to blow her off. Here is my song. Listen if you will. And I have no... Oh!
I sing it wrong.
Here is my heart. Take what you want. And I have no use for it anyway. Full of all of the stupid things I've ever said. Could be the worst, maybe the best. Those are the breaks. These are the music. I can't give myself away. I'm the only one to lose it. And I don't want to lose this. But it is the sea that makes. And the land that makes the sea. And I do not know yet what I'm made of or all I may someday be. And it is the woods that makes the carpenter. It's the very tools of his trade. And it is love that makes a love. And the cross that makes us saints. Here is my song, listen if you will. But I have no heart for it anymore. Half a mind, cut it loose. If it sails off into the blues, then I'll just let it soar. And the skies better keep me. And I won't be any poorer for giving it its freedom. And here's one for freedom. It is the sea that makes a sailor, and the land that shapes the sea. And I do not know yet what I'm made of, or all I may someday be. And it is the wood that shapes the carpenter. It's the things I've ever said. This may be the worst, could be the best. Those are the
who is longing for his home.
Oh, you don't know the motions? Oh, wait a minute, before we do that, I want to do
a hammer dulcimer. Yes.
What's that? Hammer dulcimer.
Thank you.
Yeah, did you go to France?
No, I went to Washington.
Awesome guy!
Thank you.
I first liked him when I was hitchhiking one time in eastern Wyoming, and the guy dropped me off. The last ride that I had for a long time dropped me off. I was standing by the side of the road, and I looked around, and I'm going, and I watched him pull away, and I watched him for hours. He was driving pretty fast, and I thought, man, there is nothing else in sight. And if a car were to come before they got here, from the time I'd see him, I'd have time to shower and shave and maybe up my chances of getting a ride. Then I started feeling really conspicuous, because I was the only bump on the landscape. And somehow that juxtaposition of feeling very small and insignificant, because the area around you is so huge, feeling that small and then feeling that conspicuous, I think it's really dizzying. And I love getting dizzy, and since I have so many Baptist friends, I don't have a lot of ways of doing that anymore. So that's why I moved out to the place, so I can just stay that way and not offend anybody. I think once you have that experience, once you get a whiff of what the prairies really are, you really like it.
Amen.
And everybody else passes them by because they're on their way to Colorado. But Mitch and actually all three of us have lived in Kansas, and the other guy that plays with us is also from Kansas. So we have a place in our hearts for the prairie. And this is another song of Mitch's that I think is kind of a prairie kind of song. Is there anything you'd like to see about yourself? That's why we're in a small group together.
Your word is flames that goes upon my face, and it will remain when all else fades away. And in the midst of change, one thing still stays the same. So I walk by faith, don't scare to even hope that I can learn to love as my heart unfolds. But sometimes I just need an angel to tell me not to be afraid. From out of nowhere, from out of the blue, these clouds like holy prophets groaning through on the winds of love and rage. So come, Lord, and wash me clean in your salt, until it sinks deep down into my bones. Stand in the gentle fall of the gospel rain. And beneath that falls is a kind of burning bush, and I can hear your call when I stop to look. Tell me you're there, whatever happens, and I can hear the trees clap in their hands. From out of nowhere, from out of the blue, these clouds like holy prophets groaning through on the winds of love and rage. So come, Lord, and wash me clean in your song, until it sinks deep down into my bones, as I stand in the gentle fall of the gospel rain. Reaches deep and something moves inside of me. From out of nowhere, from out of the blue, these clouds like holy prophets groaning on the winds of love and rage.
dulcimer that is not... This actually is a biblical instrument, so I always feel real holy when I play it. And this is another instrument that's called a dulcimer, and it's certainly not biblical. It's actually Appalachian. This was invented. I love myths because they're myths are true because you can never argue with them. You know what I mean? So when someone say, "Oh, that's a myth," you go, "Yes, absolutely. That's why it's true." And they're always true, and they're inarguable. But there is a legend that the pilgrims came to this country because they wanted religious freedom, which anyone that's even had a mild introduction to American history knows that can't possibly be true. And I come from a mixed background. My mom was Quaker, so we hate Puritans because they used to hang Quakers for entertainment on Saturday afternoons. They were so religious and godly and stuff. And my dad was Irish, and so that, you know, the Puritans, even centuries later after they had long given up believing in God, they still hated Catholics because they still didn't like drinking, brawling, or making babies. And the Irish, being Catholic, were really good at all those things. And so they couldn't get jobs in when they would get to Boston or anywhere where there's a bunch of Puritans. And oh, incidentally, the evil king of England that the United States rebelled against. I had this lady one time. We were doing a concert around Halloween, and I, just trying to be nice, I said, "Wow, you know, you have such a beautiful city here, and all the jack-o'-lanterns look so cool on the way into the concert. You know, they were all lit up, and it just really looked pretty." And this lady came up afterwards, and she was really mad, and she said, "You know, why are you advocating the celebration of Halloween?" I said, "I wasn't. I was just looking at carved up pumpkins." And she said, "Well, don't you know that Halloween is of the devil?" And I said, "Well, you know, I'm sorry, I still like pumpkins with candles in them. I'm not sure I'm satanic or anything." She said, "Well, do you have children?" I said, "No." And she said, "Well, if you had children, you would understand." I said, "Man, if I had children, we would carve pumpkins year round. We would light candles in your honor." "So, lady, do you like firecrackers?" And she said, "Yes." And I said, "Well, do you associate firecrackers with any holidays?" She said, "Yes." I said, "What? 4th of July." I said, "Well, what is the 4th of July a celebration of?" She said, "It's a celebration of our independence." I said, "You're wrong. It's a celebration of a rebellion against the rightful king of England. And doesn't the Bible say that rebellion is as under witchcraft? So if you can have your firecrackers, I'd like my jack-o'-lantern. We'll just call it evil." The evil king of England was the guy that created, it was a big mistake, I think, but he made Rhode Island as a sanctuary for Baptists because Puritans not only didn't like Catholics or Quakers, they also didn't like Baptists, and probably for more reasons. And Maryland was created as a sanctuary for Catholics because all the colonists were so big on religious freedom. Does anybody know the only colony of the original 13 that had religious freedom guaranteed in its constitution? Pennsylvania, the Quaker state, and the rest of y'all caught on later. So when our family came over from Ireland, they couldn't get jobs in Boston because of all the Puritan influence still up there. So a lot of the Irish ended up in Appalachia mining coal, which is what my dad's family was. That was my dad's. I used to be real embarrassed about my dad being a hillbilly and stuff. And then one time I was down there for a funeral because, you know, they all have those huge families, so there's always people dying. And in fact, we have such great funerals in our family that I really came to suspect that my aunts were bumping off my uncles just so they could throw a party. And we were driving down the road, and all of a sudden my dad got out of the car and went, "Oh man, what? So it used to be right here." And my aunt got out and she said, "What used to be here?" And he said, "Remember that tree where we used to swing out over the river?" And she said, "No, the river has changed. When they put the road in, the course of the river changed." We started talking about all this wild stuff about how they used to They used to go up on Public Black Mountain, and they had just pedal bikes. They didn't have gears on their bikes, and they would take the chains off of them. And then see who could coast the farthest down the mountain without brakes. And just to prove how brave they were. You gotta remember, they were hillbillies. And they were talking about this glory weed they used to smoke, which I'm sure was just plain old marijuana. And suddenly, thinking about my dad smoking grass and riding a bike down a hill with no chain on it, all of a sudden I realized that for years I had related to my dad only as an authority figure, and that I had never really respected him as a human. And I'd forgotten that maybe he got drunk the first time once, and that he had fallen in love the first time once. That at different points he had really made commitments to God and really had failed in being able to follow through with them. Suddenly, instead of being this guy that I argued with, which I never argued with him a lot because he didn't take it very well, and I didn't take it very well, all of a sudden he became a human being. And I think one of the ways that you honor your father and mother is you study the culture that they grew up with, and you come to appreciate them for who they really are instead of for how you do them. That's what this song is.
Thank you.
Will the waves crash in the tide? Some angry sea, but there is no doubt that the light out will keep shining out to warn a lonely sailor. And the lightning strikes in the waves with the sailor's boat, the sailor's soul. There's nothing left except the rolling ocean. Oh, I am ready for the storm. Yes, sir, ready, oh, give me rest to go out, where every conversation seems to tell me what it really means to be this lonely sailor. When the sky begins to clear, the sun it melts away my fear, and I cry a silent weary tear for those who mean to love me. Oh, I am ready for the storm. Yes, sir, ready, I am ready for the storm. Ready for the storm. It is no real friend. Time will take its time and you will find it in the end. Bring to me this lonely sailor. When you take me by the hand, then you know me more. You know me, and I should have realized I have no reasons to be frightened. I am ready for the storm. Yes, sir.
Thank you. Thank you.
cross. Hope in heaven not to be forgotten that our God is an awesome God. Those are